All right, looking forward to this masterclass. You know, the most important thing for us to be remembering is that we're here for us to share ideas and for all of us to learn. So if you have any questions, etc., so don't be shy to, just make an inquiry and then we can share ideas, etc. Okay, very good. So let's see. Well, there's Raymond over there. All right. Good morning. Oh, good evening for you.
Good morning.
Hi.
Good morning.
Hi.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay.
So what will you be performing for us?
Today I'll be playing the third movement of the second clarinet concerto by Weber.
Nice.
Thank you.
Bravo, bravo, bravo. That was great. I like it. I like it a lot. Yeah, that's fantastic. Congratulations. Yeah, Raymong, you're sounding awesome, awesome, awesome. So that's very good. And, you know, I am very also super impressed with, you know, how yeah, the little details that we discussed before you were able to implement them so fast. That is really, really great. So congratulations. That sounds fantastic. So just since you're doing so well, then I just had just some minutiae little details for us to continue to do a little bit of refinement, just working backwards, okay? It was very good. Just make sure when, you know, the last page, when we get really a little bit excited sometimes when we're playing the forte, the... make sure that that you have to be thinking about the bottom, right? We have the our arpeggio. So then sometimes when we start getting a little too excited, start in the forte after the... and they start getting a little too low, okay? So just make sure that in the excitement, we have to, you know, keep also, you know, we're putting the, pushing the gas, but we have to know exactly where that, the break is just in case for the curves, right? So just do a little bit of the beginning, okay? And make sure that... okay, so then we can get those notes. Let me hear it just a little. Excellent, excellent. And the same thing. So it's basically, it's only basically the amount of tonguing that we're using. So then you can link just like how you did. Then that one has also nice focus, okay? So then it's not... okay, so just let's make sure that we continue having... So then it sounds fireworks, but, you know, as we know for those fireworks, you know, for them to have those shapes, everything is very controlled, especially when you have it in the little bones for it to go. So when it goes, it has a shape. It's not like, ah! Okay? So let's just hear one last time. Very good, very good, very good. Excellent, excellent. And then, so you see, like in slow motion, you see that we're getting... it's a little uneven. So we can practice it a little bit for it. So then it's basically in a loop of a phrase loop. So it's not bam, 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 but we are building to the top and then we come down, okay? So. Okay, so even though, I mean, like when we're going a little bit excited, it's a little bit, you know, just let it all go. But the thing at the same time is like the thing that will keep us sort of in control is having the shape for the phrase. Okay, so let's just one last thing, just a little bit. And let's, since we're going slow, let's make sure that we can shape the sound so then we don't go. Oh, it is basically just like how you were playing in the middle, in the trio, that you're making a very beautiful sound there. Right? So we're shaping. It's not just blowing and then moving the fingers. So we're always shaping the phrase. So let's check it out. That So yeah, that's what I mean. That's what I called it. That's the what we're talking about. That's the expensive sound. Yeah, very good, very good, excellent, very good. So that is excellent. Now the starting again from the beginning. You know, everything is coming along extremely well, right? It's just as we discussed before, just maybe a little bit of the phrasing, right? When we are doing in this piece, especially, you will notice when you get to play this. I'm sure you get to play it very soon and many times the whole concerto. By the time that we get to this movement, the first movement is pretty long and pretty intense, and the second. So by the time we get here, the reed will be happy, but maybe a little tired. So we have to practice. I would recommend practice this movement with a reed that would be less than ideal in the soft side, so that then we learn to control the articulation. Because when we use it at the beginning, it's perfectly fine. But sometimes when the reed is a little bit tired, then we go and then it gets a little ta 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 ta. So we want to make sure that it's melodic, okay? Right? Okay, fair enough. And the only reason why that's happening is because, you know, we are a little bit already comfortable and the reed is a little easy, tired, right? So let's just practice this articulation going D. So for expression, but always the tongue is like the spatula for the shaping the frosting on the cake. So it's nice and light. Okay. Very good. Okay, so that articulation, but I don't want you to get shy though. Okay, so that was a good process. Now with the spicy meatball like you did before, okay? Then the thing that will give it a little bit of life is that the D, do, si, re, do, pam, 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 ta, ta, ta. Then you get the, then you're gonna get the little second. Hey, I wanna say a shout out to my friend, John Ye. Hey, how are you, man? Good to see you. But okay, so and then, see the original, the manuscript doesn't have the do si si lo, it just has the B flat, right? So that then when we do, you see that I'm trying to match the color for the B flat. No. Okay, so the little grace note, okay, the little grace note is added by Heinrich Berman, okay? So it's sort of like it's a way of making it even more flamboyant, right? So it, yes, we want it to stick out, right? But let's make sure that we can do it with the beautiful sound that you're using for the first two measures, okay? So. That's right. Yes, excellent. Okay, so that is really great. Great. Now, in order to get the we need just a little bit of separation in the syncopation, so that it doesn't sound. So then it's like it is long but not sustained, right? So then it's like a bell, bum bum ba bum. So but you see that there's a little tail of sound, right? But it's not. You see, so I'm still blowing air and there's still sound. Yeah. Yes. Yes, very good. And then let's not forget that we're going to use that first measure as what? The upbeat for the next. Do, si, re, do, re, mi, fa, fa, sol, la, right? So we have to make sure that the syncopation has a little bit of tension. Do, si, and then da, ga, da. So then it helps us for the phrasing. Very good. And then that is absolutely fantastic. Then the last little detail to be just, you're sounding great, but I'm supposed to be saying stuff here. You know, you're making me work hard. So the thing is that the little rhythm, that one also is always a little tricky because it's sort of fast, right? No. It's getting a little comfortable, and this one should be like the most explosive little thing. Okay. Oh yeah, it's very good. It's only the top one. I'm getting redo a little bit later. Yeah, sorry. Let's imagine that you have a downbeat. Yes, all right. That's very good. Now let's put it all together. Those four measures. Or six, I forgot to count. Okay. Wait, okay. So you see, I'm saying that you're already counting. Don't count with the clarinet, okay? Just count it inside. And then for the beginning, I need you to tank up a little bit more. So imagine that you're going to be, you have to be thinking of the orchestra. Bum, 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 bum. You're going to be breathing right there. Okay. So three beats. One. You see, so then it's basically, if you tank up, you could do the whole few measures in one breath. So then if you have a longer line, and then you can secure the response. Yes, that's it. But you see, now this is we're splitting hairs, okay? So while we're doing that, I don't the only thing that I would like to encourage you is to not lose the spirit, though, because you're doing it very free and with panache and freedom. So just keep it like that. You know, all these little details are for us to know and for nobody else to find out. It's like, it sounds so free and sounds very detailed, but we work the details, but over here, you know, quietly. And then you just have to, over there, you have to toss it. It's a spicy, it's a big salad. Yeah, we want the best little tomatoes. We slice them very well, and the little shallots. But that's over there in the kitchen. You know, now you're playing the masterclass. It's like, look at this. Wow, look at this fantastic stuff. Okay, so just play it out. Let's try. Yeah, that's excellent. Okay, and then continue. Yeah, so you see that one's very good. Then the little gap. See how we make the A when we get a diminuendo on the A, we don't just play soft, but we turn it to be from the bravura to, yes, I'm a virtuoso, but I'm also romantic. Listen to this poetry on this fancy note, okay? And then we go back to playing around and being happy, okay? Let's try it. Yeah, you see what I mean? So now you have virtuosity, you have the spiciness from the syncopations, and then the rhythmic vitality and smoothness, you see? All of that within two phrases, right? So you show ultimate musicianship immediately, all right? Now let's, please start from the beginning, just all of that we just did. Fantastic. That is absolutely beautiful. You see? Then it is really, really great. So I really, really like that. I would call it about A+. Very, very good. Very good. Okay. So you did all the other little things in I would like for you to basically what we can do for this movement is cut and paste, right? Basically what we were talking about in terms of the spots that have the dolce quality, just to make sure that we can make them very nice and smooth. Okay, so that's very good. Now, like I said, when we go in the development, right, is also I would say, you know, for me also, I get overexcited to play the fortissimo. Okay, so for this, I'm gonna give you a little trick, okay? Now, in the orchestra, when you're playing the solo, you know, the orchestra will go, wham, pa, pa, da, and it's just like, it resonates a lot, okay? And there's a chance that you will still be heard, but it's like you're like in the pool, and sometimes, I'm over here, I'm not drowning, right? But we're having fun, but ooh, easy, right? So when we get into that place, we sometimes get overexcited and then we try to compensate, and that's where we tend to lose the sound. So because we're thinking, oh, it's not gonna project, so then we play too loud. So for that little part, one trick that works is you can try by putting the bell up a little bit. So you're gonna be sort of more forward, not quite like Mahler, but first of all, it looks really impressive. People like it. It's like, wow, it looks so determined. Right? So it's like pointed a little forward like that. And because it's like that, then the sound comes out direct, much more like that. So then you don't have to play too loud. And then you can control it. And so it projects better. You get more brilliance. And you don't have to work so hard, so you can control it. And it looks good. So let's try that. Okay. Yes, that's what I'm talking about. Okay. So you see, that's fantastic. Okay. So then, because I actually, when I do that, the other thing that it helps me is like, oh, because I'm getting this angle, I can look a little bit with the bottom of my eyesight, so I can see a little bit more what's going on here. So that then, I mean, it's just a little bit. Then it actually makes me feel more secure, so I don't move around too much, because you don't want just a little that we get the ambulance, the Doppler effect. Okay, so for that one. So those four measures, you can feel free to be expressive. For those four measures, we have to make sure that we don't fall off our pony. That's what I call, okay. So for those four, just make sure that we're right there and then you let go. Okay, so let's see if you can go from there. Do re mi la 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 sol fa mi re do from there, but don't move around too much. Just bring up the bell. See, bring up the bell. Bring up the bell and don't move too much. Excellent. You see? So that way you have the power, the intensity, and the accuracy. And it looks really determined. All right. You know, it's a little bit of showbiz. You have to be, a little bit. It sounds great. Congratulations, Raymond. Do you have any questions?
So should I repeat the things you told me, like, all around the piece?
Whenever you have something soft, remember, it's not, like with the orchestra, it's not going to be always soft in volume, okay? Remember, the piano in here, you will see that most of the pianos, they put a dolce and everything in there, which means that it's sweet. Go for the color and the character, the sweet expression first, and I think that if you think that the dynamic will help you get there, right? But what you want is to make sure that you have a cantabile style that changes the color, because you just finished that, right? And then you can play soft, but it's a soloistic soft, right? It's not that soft. It's not, right? So then it's basically so that then when you're doing that, it's just to basically soften the sound. Like you did that very well, but it's just always remember that it's more about the character. You have the slick, expressivo character, and then the determined, megastar character, and you play around with those, and then we do the dynamic to correspond. But first the character, then the dynamic. Okay. Bravo. Very, very good job. All right.
Thank you.
All right. Excellent. All right. So, my friends, who is next?
That's me.
Oh, there she is. Shinie, how are you?
Good, and you?
All right, very well. So we are doing?
Franz Vincent Krommer's Clarinet Concerto, the second movement.
Yes.
Thank you.
Lovely, lovely, very, very nice. Congratulations. I really like it. This is very nice. The sound you make is very, very beautiful. And I like how you connect the notes. It's very nice. For this one, I think that, the rhythm and the sound is very nice. I think that you can go with, I mean, it's like lovely. Maybe we can exaggerate a little bit the cover for the little phrases. The good thing is that this, we have a very big line, but within the big line, then we can make a little bit of contrast. For example, when we start, one of the tricks that I try to do for this one is like, we tank up and then we start preparing the air, like for the first, at least the two beats before we play. So it's like we breathe and then we're already sort of like, since it's a short phrase, already exhaling. So it's like 1, 2, 3, and then. This is like, I'm not like having to guess. Okay, so it's like I took a breath and then 1. Right? So you can put a little bit more sound, okay? Let's try. Lovely. Very good, very good. You see, but very good. Okay, so since you already played this very well, we're gonna just make little stuff just to bring those little details a little bit more. So you see, like la re re mi re, we had a little hairpin. Okay, then here, this second phrase, I would suggest, you can still do the hairpin, but I would say usually. Especially in phrases that are consecutive, that we have a similar gesture, right? We do similar, which is okay, but not exactly equal, right? So for this one, I would suggest, since you have the little trill, etc., use the trill to create a little bit more excitement. So the hairpin, I would suggest, is a little bit bigger. So go to your D and be a little bit louder, okay? Right, we are really more sound. So that way, when you do that, then it gives you more room for the next phrase. So we taper to mezzo forte, right? So it's not too soft. So then we have the two little, one two major phrase, one two bar phrase, and then we start, instead of with a period, then there are commas. Please on me, love a re, and then you finish the phrase that gets expanded, right? So from 2, 2, and then 4, right? So let's try that. Very good. Okay. Now, very, very nice. The only thing is that it's very, very good. But on the high D, you should change it a little bit, just a little. Breathe. Okay, so then you have a little bit more time for that breath, okay? So you can be more expressive. Now, you see, from the... So this one already is a little variation on the beginning, right? Si, sol, mi. Si, da, 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 right? And then la, fa, re. And then this one goes all the way to the top, right? So what I would say is that then you have a little bit of room to sort of get a little bit more excited. I'm not going to say that it's faster. I'm going to call it more fluid. Okay, it's a different, right? So then, yeah. So then our teachers don't get on our case. Hey, you're rushing, right? But just a little bit. You see, so then we add, because we take those two breaths, then we can be much more expansive, okay? So then take the breath, re, mi, fa, sol, la, si, do, re, right? A little bit bigger breath, so that then you can maintain the sound, okay? So let's go from re, mi, fa, 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 sol, la, si. Very good. So you see, this is very, very nice. So this scale, then the two little important things is just to make sure that it sounds like you are improvising it. How do we do that? Is that we have to make sure that we have a little bit more anchor at the beginning and then a little bit more sweep. More sweep means a little bit bigger crescendo. So then... I am going here and there, but don't carry me. If I move forward, I'm going, but don't push. If I move back, great, but don't pull. Right? It's yours. It's for you to decide how much we're going to go. Okay? So that means that at B, yes, it's a little bit bigger, but make sure that where you're going to play big is in the big runs. Okay? So... okay, feel free. Beautiful, great. Now, since that trill, it takes that's a very long four beats, right? I think that we can pace getting a little bit faster later, if you like, okay? I would suggest, you know, for trills in general, we have to know where the emphasis of the phrasing will go without the trill, and then we use the dynamic and the speed of the trill to give us our intensity. So for this one, I believe we start 1, 2, and we're at 3, 4, 1, right? So the third and fourth beats are the biggest, and then we resolve at the downbeat, right? So then that means that you have a little bit of room. So start your trill a little bit slower and maintain it slower, speeding it little by little, okay? So. You see, so it sounds very busy, but I'm actually pacing myself. It's not, you don't wanna go. Oh my God. How was the count? I forgot, right? So the thing is, so basically you, let's go the trill one, the first two beats are slow, the third beat, it's when we get it fast, the fourth beat, we get it brilliant, and then we have a slow down, so that then we can do the little turn at the end. Right? So let's try just the trill. La sol again. Yeah, you see what I mean? That is beautiful. Excellent. Very good, very good. Now, yes, so there's one little fingering that I wanted to share with our friends and with you. So for this one, because these are our C sharp, D flat tends to be very brilliant and sort of a little picante. A little sharp. So then we want to avoid that, especially a D flat that we have to keep the intonation down. Do you know the chromatic D flat or C sharp? So we play high C, right? You do that one with the two trill keys. So it's high C and then these two. Let's try, because it's just do that. Do re, just those two notes. Very good. Now, very good. Now that is the basic. Okay, that's what for when we're doing a trill from C to D flat or something like that. Now for the melodic kind, then that is too many keys that are open and it's very a little too much. So what we do is we temper it. So we add the third finger here and the C sharp key. So these two. So it's these two and those two. So then it's like. Absolutely. You see what I mean? So that then it's nice and round, especially the older one where we are tapering off. You know, that sounds really great. I'm glad that you got that so fast, especially for the next phrase. Right? Because that one is less. You don't want. Oh, okay. Continue. And then we're going to use the same fingering. Right. And because, you see, that's absolutely lovely. But you see, the emphasis is on the appoggiatura, right? So it's on the do, okay, yeah, so let's try that. Very good, very good. You know, I appreciate that the first time you tried to do that long one that we worked and it betrayed you a little bit. But, you know, new friends sometimes, are like, they take a little time for us to, you know, be able to be best friends. But you did this one, the safer one, it's very good. But, you know, so I like it, it's very round. But, you know, if you like then re, mi, fa, then you use the sliver. Remember that we're going to use re, mi, and then you can go in the little corner, so we're not over here, fa, and then actually for it not to be complicated, then you can leave it for sol, la, for the G sharp and the A, but for two reasons, it will make the G sharp a little bit higher, which makes it a nicer leading tone to the A. And the A, when we are playing in that register and we sometimes coming from the top, and since we're rounding up the embouchure, we tend to get a little spready, myself too. So it's like, yeah, we want to make sure that doesn't happen. So. So that definitely helps. And so, fantastic. Absolutely, absolutely great, absolutely great. Then the last little thing, just to double check with you. So you see, it's like how Krommer adds intensity by repeating the note, being much more insistent. You see, like in the a regular recap would be la la re re re, okay? But he la 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 la. Are you really gonna, please, are we really going to have a banana split? Okay, so we need a little bit more of that intensity. So, especially after the, after going too high, right? Then you see, then we, it's basically variations on the theme, right? We have re, mi, fa, mi, fa, do, mi, re, si, la, so, fa, mi, re, do. You see, so he puts the little extra notes to make sure that we are never stuck, okay? Move. It's like, we're moving a little bit more. Oh, my heart aches. Okay, let's just try that from mi, re, mi, re, fa. Okay. Yes. Very, very nice. Very, very nice. So it sounds really great. The last little bit is, yes, you see, he repeats that little phrase again. La la si do mi mi re mi redondo re. And then the, it's even with a little bit more longing, okay? So you can start it a little bit, you can do a little crescendo on it. And then we're gonna change where solo is. We're getting to our fine line note. We're gonna play it a little longer because we like it. Okay? No. No. We arrive, we give you the last note. At least a whole quarter note with a taper. Let's just go the last three measures. Absolutely beautiful. Very nice. Shinie, you're doing very, very, very nice. It's very pretty sound, and I like your connecting the notes, etc. You're doing very, very, very beautifully. Now, do you have any questions?
No. Thank you so much.
Are you sure? Don't be shy. Oh, wait, I pressed something wrong here. Okay. Well, no, it sounds absolutely lovely. Congratulations. Very, very good.
Bye.
All right, my friends. I see that there was some kind of question, but yeah, you know, I'm using my phone, so because my computer is sort of a little not so great. So let me just see where was this other part over there. Where were the questions? I cannot find that stuff. I'm sorry.
It's in the chat, Ricardo. I've been watching it. There it was Raymond just saying he needed to leave because he has school tomorrow because he's in Sydney.
What?
Difference. No, and someone was asking if you had original sound on, but since you're on your phone, that kind of answers that question for us.
Yeah, I did see that. I did put the original sound as far, you know, it's only as good as this iPhone little thing.
But no questions that I see that are immediate, but I am keeping track if we have stuff lining up for the Q&A at the end.
Okay, cool.
And right now we are on to our bassoon student, Jason.
All right, Jason, let me see, where are you? I cannot find you.
And I sent you his music because I'm not sure if you're as familiar with this piece or not.
Yes, thank you very much.
Yep, enjoy, guys.
Thank you. There you are. How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
All right. Thank you. Thank you. Actually quite cool. I like it. And you did a very good job. All right. So very good. Congratulations. I think that in general your sound is lovely. I like it very much. The one thing that is important though to make sure is that since you have a very nice wonderful andante in this introduction for this concertino, it's that the color you want it to be varied. And what I mean by that is you know, the use of the vibrato that you have, your what I would call your to go vibrato, okay, it's very, very good, and it works out for the vast majority of the music here. But there are certain spots where I believe that you can add a little bit more intensity to the sound. Usually, the way that that would work out is if we were to, in some places, get the sound to be a little bit more narrow, a little bit more focused, so then it would add just a little bit more intensity and to help you propel for the phrase. Okay, if, like for example, just even starting in the very first phrase, you know, as you get to that, what is that? That you show? Yeah, I think that you have. I would suggest if you're coming pretty good, nice register, you're gonna get that first diminuendo for free, right? Because you know the note's a little bit more, a little bit brighter. Yeah, I'm just talking about in the fourth measure, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so that then maybe once you get going, make sure that you have, since the piano is just going just gentle quarter notes, you have a little bit more room to float a little bit above it, okay, so that then it doesn't get too vertical, so you can remain vibrating. So why don't you try, please start at the beginning, see if we can get some of these little color changes, etc. You know, it sounds very good. I think that I really like it. The thing is, you know, at the beginning it was a little bit difficult for me to be able to hear with clarity the syncopation. Mm-hmm. Okay, so then, so you have. I would say maybe why don't we try this? This andante, right? Is just a walking pace, right? Right now it feels very good, but it's a little slow. It's an andante like my andante when after going for pancakes. It's like a different easy. So, but let's go to the breakfast place. Let's not be coming back at the beginning of the piece. So we have a little bit more purpose, okay? And then, you know, I know that this, especially the first note, we're going there, everybody claps, you tune, the piano, there's the silence, and then you're like, oh, I really, just trying to make sure that this comes out. You know, I would say that one of the tricks that I would suggest for you to do is, don't be afraid of that first attack. What you will do is get a piano in the texture, in the color, okay? So imagine that you have, instead of being, it's like, oh, it's a little constricted. Then think, I would suggest a piano like a blue whale, which is vast, but gentle, right? So that then, think I would call it a mezzo forte espressivo and dolce, but not piano. The piano just right now is giving you a place that you end up paint. It gives me the impression that you might paint yourself into a corner.
Okay.
Okay. So just like just a little bit, and then even at the beginning, for sure, you have to do a little crescendo to that C sharp, so that then I can hear. And then a little bit more bite in the syncopation. Yeah, okay. So that way, the syncopations are the driving force. It's the give and take, right? But that's like stretching the rubber band. I never did that in school, I swear. Yeah, but I saw other people do it. I learned the technique though, just in case. Yeah, but that is basically how we have to be thinking of these little syncopations. They are definitely the ways to just propel us. Okay, so let's try again. Yes, sir. It's not piano. It's your solo. It's like the sweetest sound you can make, not the softest, or just the most beautiful sound. Very nice. Jason, I would say the first four measures were really excellent. Really excellent. That's much better. It's like, before it's like, it's pretty good, but what's going on with this piece? I mean, like, immediately, this draws you in. But my poor students are like, it's very, 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 very good. But. So the thing is, But once you get to that that G sharp, the thing was that you had a beautiful syncopation and crescendo to that note, and then you should ride that wave already, like the musical surfing, right? You're at the top of that, so that's what propels you. So then don't slow down and keep the movement that you want. Ta-da, one, two, yeah, then you can rest in the long note. And then you can relax if you want. But, you know, after you get going, after that fourth measure, I would say the fifth and sixth measures are moving forward, okay, in a fluid way. So that way you can shape better. And you see, because it's going to be moving a little bit more, then you don't have to save air. Mm-hmm. Meaning that what I mean by that is that sometimes when we see phrases that seem long, you know, like in here, that looks very long like that, but I would say those are indications for the phrasing. Mm-hmm. I would not necessarily feel that those are the indications for when you are allowed to breathe. Mm-hmm. Okay, meaning that if you need to breathe in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 after the 4-4 measure, if you feel like it, if you I'd rather you take a breath, take a little pause and go, rather than okay, it's pretty good, but I need to save air, so I have to reduce the fire. Okay, but it's like we already are boiling the eggs, you know, I already seen the bubble. It's a little anticlimactic too. I don't want to cook it too soon. Yeah, let's keep going, you know. It's your moment to be expressivo, okay? One last time from the beginning. That was great, but then just continue from that same intensity in the fifth, sixth measure and beyond, okay?
You want me to start at the beginning, correct?
Yes, please. Because I want you to ride that wave that was so good. Yeah. Very, very nice. Okay, that is definitely to my ears over here. It sounds much more compelling. It sounds beautiful, and then you're using your vibrato, and you sound much nicer. Then you have that. Whenever you know, especially this piece, I'm finding at least at this beginning, the way that he displays it, the syncopations are. It's just to get you to move forward. So. Don't ever feel like you are settling them. Now, one interesting trick that we can do in order for us to sound expansive is that in music, it's a give and take of rhythm, fluidity, and paucity, and just settling, which means that for a tempo like this, I think I know that I get the impression that you have a slower tempo than what I have in my mind, seeing the score, etc. But the thing, which is okay, it's perfectly cool. But the thing is that we have to always be careful that then, as we have this lower tempo, that we don't get into a place where we lose momentum, mm-hmm. right? Because music, even things that are, I mean, like. Sometimes when there is a cadenza, like let's say Shostakovich 9, that you know, that everything sort of stops, mm-hmm. and then you have this little cadenza, everything is suspended. That's actually an effect, just the being stopped, the being like suspended, right? That's an effect, but most of the time then, and then you have this, and then we go, right? So it's like, there's always, yeah, we're here, and then we have to have the thing. So since the beginning, what you have is quarter notes of the piano, just go pop, pop, pop. I think that what will help make it sound expansive but not draggy is you can ask your musical partner, your pianist, to be playing and then to be sort of on the steady side, right? And then that, then what happens is that then you can play what we call the Ormandy style. With the Ormandy style is that it used to, the orchestra plays sort of a little behind the tempo because it's like always, you know, stretching the caramel, mm-hmm. stretching that caramel, right? So that then, so I and then you can be like expansive bit, but it's like that little struggle with the piano. You're trying to be like this, but the current is trying to push you, and you're like, yeah, I'm a blue whale, I'm like enjoying the ride, don't hurry me, I'm going to do this. But there's still that movement, and they look slow because they're huge, but they're going very fast anyway, right? So that is the one thing that I would suggest. So it sounds really, really great. Now, so that definitely is the most important thing that I would like for you to get from this is how to maintain a fluidity, right? And you see the a diminuendo. Diminuendos and crescendos are things that we usually talk about, but we don't talk so much about diminuendos. And I find that diminuendos are where you get to really shape the phrase at the how the mountain, you know, you don't have a cliff, and the, you know, that's not going, a cliff is scary, but you have a mountain, then we can go hiking and everybody enjoys it. But so, and here, like this diminuendo, especially the first few, I would say diminuendo, we have to be thinking about them as verbs, okay? Right, as active verbs, which means start getting softer, okay? It's not play softer there. And then meaning that we have to be thinking always, the easiest way to think is, when you see a diminuendo, that usually is at some of the highest points of the phrase, okay? A diminuendo means play loud. Play loud and then get going. You see what I mean? And conversely, when you see a crescendo, it's like, oh, take a step back because it has to grow, right? You don't want to be too loud and have nowhere to go. So, I mean, these are, I mean, I would call these cookie cutter, you know, guidelines. Okay, so I mean, it's music is so varied and so individual that I feel a little cheesy saying it like that. Okay, but it's just an idea. So to help you so then you have a little bit easier time with the phrasing, and that then you are not so that you are not stuck. Okay, now the same thing, especially after. After, you know, when you have your first cadenza, little spot, you know, with that high E flat, you know, is that an E flat or E natural, right?
Yeah. It's up there.
Yeah. So this E natural, then, you know, you have a piano in the other thing. What I would suggest is don't play piano. What I would say is play bright and brilliant, getting to the highest sharp, right? Mm-hmm. Intense, and then play relaxed will sound softer after that intense vibrato, etc. But then you won't have to risk losing the response of the reed, right? So that then you'll be a little bit safer, and that is super important. So these are little tricks of the trade, you know, just give yourself the room so that then you have it. So would you like to try that for a second? I just need to say just that 6/4 measure before the highest sharp, you know, and then see, and then don't play piano, play round at the piano, not soft, but round. Yeah.
Hold on. Let me see if I can get one of my reads to get this note out.
You're gonna get it. But it's okay. Though it sounds very good, and even if it's a little struggle, you know, the little intensity is what's required musically speaking. You see, it's sort of like Rite of Spring, right? You guys are like, hey, yeah. If it was easy and they're getting the English, you know, you get in the English one, it's like it doesn't have the intensity. It would be like, yeah, how you doing? Hey, man. So you don't want that. You want the that intensity. So yeah, go with that read because it's something good. It's something good. And if it's like a little, that's good for the music. Okay. Well, you see, because you have that, then you know, you have to play that soft. The piano, it still has to be intense.
Okay.
Keep it intense. So that way, it's not like, oh, there's some high note there. You want, it's a high note, it's a high point. You are just have a little scream, and now you let it go, but you're still with that intensity inside. The fire. So make sure that you get the soft piano, the piano formata, that one has to sound intense. So that way it gives you room to, if that one has to scream out, the top one, okay? So it's a musical effect that then, you know, it's not just, oh, play a high note, oh, so well, it's pretty good, nice. Yeah, we, instrumentalists, woodwind players, it's like, yeah, we get impressed with that. But for somebody who doesn't know the piece, they'll need to be excited. Whoa, yeah, what happened here, right? So that is the color. And then you are much more free to be expressive with that, okay? So just to recap, okay, you're doing extremely well. Just use the momentum, okay? Every syncopation is a rubber band. It's how to move, okay? It's not to slow you down, but it's actually to propel you forward with especially after the syncopation happens, okay? Then the intensity has to be guided. We have to guide the crescendo with the focus of the sound and the speed of vibrato, okay? It cannot be the same lovely vibrato in the forte as in the piano. You have to get more intense for sure. Okay. Those two things will definitely help you to keep everything coming along a little bit more fluid. Okay. Sounds excellent. Do you have any questions?
No, sir.
No? You sure? Don't be shy.
I'm sure.
Well, congratulations. Very nice job. Very nice. Excellent. All right. So now we have. All right. Let's see what's going on. What are we doing this morning?
I'm going to play the second movement of the Mozart clarinet concerto.
Ooh. That's nice stuff. Let me get that guy out.
Thank you.
Bravo. So, I would like to have a very overall sound, very great, and your sense of humor is very long. For this, in general, actually, I like that you have really, really good people, which is great.
That work?
How's that? Yeah, that's better. Yeah, excellent. Okay. Thank you. So, so what was happening is that then, yeah. So in general, the quintet, right? The quintet is actually the fluid one, and actually, sort of for you for this movement, I would say basically the opposite of Jason, right? Like right here, I think that then you can be a little bit more expansive, so that then when you go, then it doesn't feel like you're having to raise, okay? So that then, so let's think maybe in general just a little bit slower, okay? Then the next thing that is very important for us for today is the articulation, okay? It's very clear, but you know, maybe it's with my phone over here or whatever, but it's perhaps a little overly clear, so it feels a little heavy. Then it's like ta 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 ta, okay. And what you want to be make sure is that we have a little bit of room for it to be very loving, okay, and for it to be a little bit nicer. So why don't we start at the beginning, okay? See if we can. When you do do fa la, see if you can get a little bit more intensity in the air between the C and the F. Otherwise, we always get, and that not always pops out, so we have to be careful. Okay, so let's try. Very nice. Right. Now, the other thing is that for us that are in our clarinet, we have a couple of notes that, you know, for because of the kind of board that is polycylindrical, we have certain notes that we have to do little compromises. And one of them is that long C, because it bends from like just out of this last tone hole and then the bell, right? So we are sort of far. So in order for the clarinet to sound sort of okay for that intonation, then we have what we call a compromise note, so then that tone hole gives us what I call a flarp note. So it's flat on the bottom and sharp on the top. Not super flat. It has to be flat but not horrible. So that then when we're on the top, it's a little sharp but not horrible, right? So it's a little. So what does that mean for the beginning? What that means is that if it's our fifth, you know, on our F, concert F for our F major, written F major for us, but it's like the A, but it's like the fifth for this, which is okay for it to ride. But what you have to make sure is that then you have to focus your F, okay? So we have a good fourth. You cannot be, it's like, it's too short, right? So for that, we have to make sure that our embouchure is nice and tight, and that we push, even in the soft quiet, it's like, you have to be thinking, oh, we are in the river, it's quiet, but there's that current of the stream, right? The current, it keeps the whole thing going. So that's how we need to have for the air. Fast air. And then for this one, for the next phrase, let's see if we can squeeze and release the finger. Right, so then it's not. I think that for security, you want. And there's a little pop, so just a little yee, like the tonguing is like this. It's not there, but there. That's right. It's always tricky. See, we can. You have to time count beforehand, right? A whole three beats, 1, 2, 3, and then keep thinking that you have to push your thumb up, okay? So then we don't get to clamp down, but it's going up to the teeth, right? So then it's not too tight. Very good. Okay, sorry to stop so much in this beginning, but it's like, it's impossible. Mozart, you know, he was, people say he was a nice guy, but man, he wrote hard music. It seems nice, but it's sort of hard. So you see, now you get me an absolutely beautiful do, fa, absolutely great, A plus. Then, because of those notes being so good, then it puts a lot of pressure on that A to be nice, which means that we have to match the color. We're gonna go. No. Okay, so let's try. Excellent. Beautiful. Very good. Now, this is that's absolutely great. Way better. That, how does that feel? Does it feel okay, or is it a little bit?
That feels fine. It feels like I'm. I don't know. I have like a lot more mouthpiece in, and my, I don't know. It feels like my arm is kind of tensing up from like.
Okay. That, but it's not all. You know, it's just mostly for the first two notes. It's just to get us going, and then we can relax. It's supposed to be bringing up, actually, to create the opposite effect. So then, so we don't go like this, because this is pushing up, it's pushing up to the teeth on the top, right? Which means that then it's releasing the pressure on the reed. And then once we get the reed vibrating and going, then all bets are off, then you can play normal, okay? So it's just get started. Make sure that we're not biting, and then we go, okay? So that's very good. Then, it sounds absolutely great. Then the end then of this phrase, actually, you know that Mozart puts the little 16 note, right? It's not, and then, so the rhythm, and then you have the little sextino. Right? So, you know, he knows how to write mi, fa, da, da. Right? So it's one of these weird things that we have to practice not being precise. You know, so that then it doesn't sound. Any number of those, but no, right? So that's all, you know, it's one of those that you get to experiment. You'll find the ones that you like the best. And of course, since it comes a couple of times, then you'll do it differently the next time for sure, right? So that's good. Then the next thing is, yeah, so that thing about the thumb up also is important for the next two entrances, right? For the So then we have the thumb note. And then we can keep those. Let's try. Two and three and. Nice. Very nice. Now, the other thing is that was very good for that note. Now, once you get it, do, si, la, sol, fa, si, la, sol, si, sol, fa. Let's not forget that little appoggiatura, those are the ones that, you know, when we're talking about interpretation, those are the ones that we call, this is our license. This is for you to have your signature call, okay? So, because it's not exactly precise, you can do it a little before, a little after, a little on, a little fast, a little slow. And so then, you know, but it's to be also, because that is your little spot to shine, it has to be emphasized ever so slightly, okay? So it doesn't sound. Did I play it? I don't know, I forgot, but. Any number of them, but it's not just so that then you feel free to be expressivo with it. Okay. Now, so when we get to the little development, then yes, this is one of the things that is very important to try to make sure that this is why the tempo has to be one in which the orchestra flows and then you are sort of expansive on it. So that. Right, so then it's like not. Oh, then it creates a little bit of a little bit of a tension. Here we are just giving you a story. Yeah, okay. So let's try from there and see if we can go a little bit more relaxed. If you're going to tone those, yeah, those have to be super light, okay? I would say, I mean, in something like that, I would avoid engaging the tongue too much. If anything, you can do yee, 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 like portato. If you want to do that. For me, in my... in my opinion, it's actually, since you have all the flourish, okay, I would just contrast that. So then I have. So those I would go for the slur and not too bumpy, okay? Right? So, I mean, you have the thing that is great about good, great, fantastic music is that you have many options, okay? Also the dangerous thing is that we do have so many options, and we have to also then become very much aware of what the style is or the performance practice, because since the music, certain music is such high quality that we could do things that are not very good musically, but it would still sound good because the music carries us. So we get a freebie, right? But we should not rely on the quality of the music to carry us through. We have to, you know, with all humility and scholarship, try to figure out what are the things that work the best. So for that, we have the flourish, and then we have the singing. You see, so he's already preparing you for the soprano and the baritone register on the clarinet. Okay, so you have the singing and then the playful. Let's try it. Lovely. Very good. You know, very nice. So the one thing that I would like to talk about a little bit for you, yeah, go ahead and blow some air for that note, okay? So the one thing that is important is to see if we can actually I want to raise the volume here. Then what you have to be thinking is that in this music, it's sort of interesting that the music is going very much stays in the same, in the key, right? The thing that makes us get the little tears to the heart are those little passing notes, okay? The ones that we have, okay? Then we have appoggiatura, right? And then, oh, we go to the our turning. A little extra tartness that gives me a little of a heartache that is delicious, right? So it's important to try to bring those out a little bit more. So that way, otherwise, it's a little too glossed over, okay? Okay, let's try that. So, yes. Very good. So, oh, yes. So before we go, the most important thing I want to go over with you is the issue of the trills, especially in slow classical style. So for this, especially in our concerto, the traditional way to get to the trill is an expansion of the rhythm that you were playing before. Okay, meaning like in here, the trill, you should start it like sort of like the same sextuple rhythm that you're using. Plus, we have the trill, especially coming from the note above. Especially if your melody is above the trill and then you're going, okay? So that then... Right, so we don't have to trill that fast, but especially if we, and then we have to show that little upper neighbor, okay? So. You see, so it's basically that same trill, but because we had that appoggiatura that we're doing a little bit, then that trill, we're already behind in the sextuple, right? So that creates the momentum. And then as we do a little bit of crescendo toward the tonic, then if we have it within us, then we could, if it's not too difficult, then we speed it up a little bit there. But you see, you don't want... because you're sort of stuck, right? The trill is to add intensity, right? So it has to be a combination of speed and volume, okay? But don't get faster than the actual volume, because what you're doing is going to the phrase, right? So that is just a little extra shine. So let's try one more time. Okay? Yes, that is actually the idea. You see what I mean? So it is always, that one is, you know, this one is always a little tricky. Not as tricky as this one or this one, but still tricky. So what we need to do is just spend a little bit of time, you know, just working on those little trills, okay? And then the last thing is when we get to the coda, okay? Make sure that that you have a little bit of time, so that then that's why it's important not to be too fast, so that then you go. You don't want, okay, you always have time. Let's try that. Do mi fa la do. Thank you. That's what I'm talking about. Excellent. And I appreciate you going for the trio and everything. That's very good. Excellent. All right. Any questions?
I did want to ask that switch from the B flat to the C sharp. I don't know. That's not as smooth as I've heard it. So how would I make that smoother?
Yeah. So this one is, unfortunately, this is one of those annoying ones in the French clarinet. In the German clarinet, you know, they usually go re fa sol si. Their B flat is here, and then it's an easier. You see, that's one of the few times that playing the German one is easier. Most of the time, it's harder. But that one is like that. So because of that. Yeah, we just have to practice that, you know, 6,000 or 7,000 times per day is just like one of those annoying ones. And in order to get the position to work better, what you can do is start practicing from the C sharp down. So instead of going from B flat to C sharp, start C sharp down. So that then you have this position right. It's just, you know, it's just a matter of, you know, 6,000 or 7,000 times, and then it's all there already.
Hey, Ricardo. Right.
Very good.
Ricardo. Yeah. Ricardo, I'm sorry to interrupt. We've gone over time, and the students need to move on to a performance class with Boris. Oh,
yes. All right, guys. Listen, thank you so much for playing so well, everybody. It was just really, really lovely to see all of you. And, you know, I wish you all the best. It's like really great. If you have any questions or anything like that, afterwards or whatever, you know, if you don't have my email, you can ask Mr. Parillo. He can get us in touch and everything so that then we can continue on the on our mutual journey of music making and good planning.
Yes. Yes, by all means, students, you can email me questions. Audience, I'm so sorry that this ran over, that we don't have time for a Q&A because I do have to move on and host our next event. But I will drop my email into the chat right now. Anyone can email me any questions as it pertains to this masterclass, and I will get them for you if I have that power. So thank you very much, Ricardo. It's always an honor and a pleasure to have you hosted at PIMF. And I know the students enjoyed it. I enjoy it. I always learn so much. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Take care, everybody.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Bye.